your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless hearts. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. God of Jacob, you use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So
everyone, to have you this morning. We just want to thank you for taking the opportunity and making this your place to be for the morning. Got a lot of needs to be praying about. Got a lot of people that's out right now. Got a lot of people that's on vacation. We're going to pray for them. Traveling Graces. Pastor and his family are actually at the General Assembly. They kept getting their flights moved, so they wind up having to fly out this morning at 5:30. So their whole family was up, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, except for Stuart. He wasn't. He was still sleepy. So he, but anyway, they got on their plane. It was so funny because we went up to North Carolina yesterday, and we was on our way home last night, and we'd just gotten back on I-75. And next thing you know, I get this white vehicle just blow past us, and the woman hanging out the window, and the husband is over there, like, picking his nose. Well, it was Stuart. It was Pastor Stuart and Lindsay. So, yeah, it was kind of weird seeing them up there. So then we, you know, we had to, you know, act goofy with each other on the interstate. So, it was, yeah, we'd have got pulled over. It'd been bad. But anyway, it was nice seeing them and everything. But yeah, y'all still remember them in the General Assembly as if they're not going to be here. I guess they're going to be there all week, I guess. So, but definitely we need to pray for Brother Jared. He's going to be bringing the word to us this morning. We're going to pray that every word out of his mouth, you know, it's just going to make preaching easy. We pray that God's going to make preaching easy for him. But listen, we got a guest. We want to thank you for being here with us this morning. If you'll fill out your guest cards, that's going to be in front of you on the back pew. Put those in the offering buckets. As they come around, take them to Guest Central. We'd love to find out and know more about you guys. A few announcements we got. Our monthly worship guide is at Guest Central, and it's going to be full of everything, the events that the church is doing for the rest of the July. The other one for August is going to be out there pretty soon. But about the last week, we'll have it set. As Pastor let us know Wednesday night that Donna got him. And, you know, we don't need what's going on in August to come, you know, like August the 7th or whatever day it'll be. Because what if anything happens the 1st of August? We don't know about it. She done missed it. So he told her he made an agreement. He'll start putting it out there the last week of the month before. So we won't miss nothing. Kids Summer Fun Night is going to be Wednesday, July the 27th at 6:30. This week's Water Wars theme. Last week was Color Fest, and that asked Stuart about that. He sort of almost, I think, lost friendship in one of his close friends that come and got him and told him to come outside that the kids want to take a picture with you. Listen, If anybody comes to you and tells you the kids want to see you outside and they got chalk and they just want to take a picture with you, listen, they can crop me in that picture, you know. You're fixing to be covered. So if you've seen the pictures of Stuart, yeah, he got slammed. He got covered with all different colors. It was hilarious. It was fun. I'm glad it wasn't me. So... But the Water Wars is going to be for all the boys and girls clubs. They'll need to bring a towel and an extra set of clothes with them. Adults will stay in the sanctuary. August the 21st at 6 p.m. is going to be Mission Sunday with missionary Stephen Harrelson. He is one of our missionaries that we support monthly. I believe he's been to the church a couple times since. There will be a special offering that Sunday night for him and his family. August the 26th through the 27th is going to be the Priceless Women's Conference. Please turn in all your money now for prices and details. You'll get with Miss Lindsay on that. So we're going to be talking about our offering this morning. You got different ways that you can do your offering. It's going to be your traditional way. It's going to be the buckets as we pass around the buckets this morning. And also you can download the Vanco app, go on the Vanco and give your tithes and offering that way. Or you can go to Fairview Church of God, churchofgod.org, click Fairview and give that way. And you also have the vision that you can designate also for the vision of the church, what we've got going on here. We look for things that God's going to bless us in that. He's going to bless you in all your giving, whether it's your tithes, your offerings, special gifts. God's going to bless you for that. So if we get our ushers to come forth to take up our tithes and our offering. Okay, that's good deal. We got enough now. Amen. We're going to, hey, just because pastor's not here, that don't mean anything. We still got a man of God that's going to bring forth the word, and it's the same word that pastor brings forth. It's the same word that can save, can heal. It don't have to be one man. God uses many people, okay? He uses everybody, whether you open up and let him use you or not. So if everybody will stand, if you got any prayer requests, if you'll just raise your hand, we'll go before the Lord. Dear gracious Father, Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, God. Lord, we just want to thank you and praise your sweet name, Father, for everything that you do, God. Watch over us to keep us safe, Father, God. Touch our pastor and his travel, Father, God, with his family, God. Touch him and sing with your good to, God. Lord, touch his praise team this morning, Father, God. Lord, touch all the prayer requests that the people that have raised their hands for, God, the spoken, the unspoken. Touch us all for, Father, God, that you'll bless him for the needs. Touch those who can't give, those who doesn't, Lord. Lord, God, touch Brother Jerry, Father. He brings forth the word this morning. Touch Brother Buddy as he brings forth the word Wednesday night. Lord, just make preaching so easy for them guys today, Father God. Just help him every word out of his mouth, Father God, to get him so easy. Lord, if also don't fall on deaf ears, Lord, then they'll fall. And everyone hear it and use it, Father God. Save the lost, save the saved, Father God. We give y'all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name.
out of the rain from the mouth of the preacher and the sinner the same, tender as a whisper, loud in its refrain. May it hang on my lips for the rest of my days. There is something about the name of Jesus. It sounds like forgiveness, sounds like amazing grace. It beckons my soul to sing forever. There's just something. When we rise and when we sleep, we speak it over sorrow, and the soul is given peace. We sing it in a famine or in prosperity, and may we never forget that He is all that we need. There is something about the name of Jesus. It sounds like
possible.
I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. 'Cause I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in. freed the captives, then you're freeing hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You touch the leper, then I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
About you, but in this atmosphere, people are being healed as we speak. As we lift our hands in worship and we lift our hands in praise, there's healings taking place right now. I believe it. I believe it. Come on, if you believe that with me today, let's gather together in worship and in praise, and let's lift up our hearts to the one who is healing our hearts right now, the one who is healing our minds right now, the one who is healing our emotions right now, the one who is setting the captive free right now. He did it then, he's doing it now. And in this atmosphere, I declare, by the grace of Almighty Yahweh God, I declare that in this atmosphere, there's freedom. There is freedom. There is freedom. I can declare that. You can declare that, because the Word declares that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom and there is liberty. There is no captivity in Jesus' name. So people have come in this place today. I feel this with all of my heart. You've come in this place today burdened. You've come in this place today, you don't know which way to turn. You don't know which way is up. You don't know which way is down. You don't know six ways to Sunday. But I'm telling you that I know a man, and his name is Jesus. His name is Jehovah. His name is Jehovah Jireh. He is the provider. He is our provider. I'm telling you, whatever you need in this room right now, Jesus is able to do that exceedingly, abundantly, above all than we could ask or ever think. I don't mean to get screaming and that music, just that music. My God in heaven. Come on, stand to your feet. If you're able, just stand up. Let's just worship him for just a minute. Let's just take about two minutes or so, and let's just worship him. Just thank him for what he is doing in your life right now.
The God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the oceans. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. And oh God, my children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You are a healer now. You
freeing hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You touch the lepers then. I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I need to tell somebody, he's never left you. He's never forsaken you. He knows exactly who you are and where you are and what you're going through. He knows you because he formed you in your mother's womb. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord this morning. Feel him in this room today. Thank you, praise team. Thank you. for leading us into an atmosphere of worship. They're not up here for a show. They're not up here for to be on a platform. If truth be known, some of these people would probably rather be sitting out in the auditorium. But it's a call and a burden on their heart that they have on them, on their lives, to lead people into worship. That's why we have a praise team. That's why we do choir. Some churches do choir. Some churches do congregational singings. That's why we do it, is to lead our hearts, get our hearts prepared in a state of worship, ready to receive what the Lord has for us. I don't know about you, but every time I go into my prayer time, I always start out by thanking the Lord for whatever that may be. It may be something different in your life. I start thanking Him for my children. I start thanking Him for my wife. I thank Him for my finances. I thank Him for health. I thank Him for all these things. But I open up, I enter into His presence with the thanksgiving. That's what worship is at church. It's entering into His presence and into His court with praise. Amen. That's not what I'm preaching on this morning. I just thought I needed to say that as an icebreaker. So, everybody okay? Everybody good? Okay. Well, I've got a word. I believe that I have a word from the Lord this morning for this house. If we've ever needed, in such a time and a day that we live in, is we need a word. How many of you can agree with that? We need a word. How many of you know that when you get in the Word, you get what you need for that day, but not, maybe not for that day, but for something upcoming that you cannot see? You cannot see. It's weeks out. It's weeks down the road. It may be years down the road, but you're reading and you're walking with the Lord and you're talking with the Lord and you're getting the Word in you, right? We get the Word in us, so what comes out of us is the Word. Okay, so when you meet that situation down the road, you can speak the word over that situation that you received in your private time. So I believe that the Lord has a word for us in this house this morning. If you're ready to receive the word, say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer real quick, and then we will get into this. Lord, we thank You for this day. God, we thank You for this atmosphere that the Holy Spirit has set in this room. God, we thank You for the atmosphere of worship that we have set in this room, for You to come in and to wreck us, God, to wreck our hearts, to wreck our minds, God, to change our way of thinking, God. We thank You, Lord, for healing. We thank You for restoration, and we thank You for Your power and Your presence in this room today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. All right, I want you to turn your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 4, starting in verse 1. 2 Kings chapter 4, everybody got it? Say amen. All right, two people. I'll give you a second. 2 Kings, it's after 1 Kings and before Revelation. I'm going to use a page out of Pastor Stewart's textbook. It's after Genesis, before Revelation. I thought that was pretty good. 2 Kings chapter 4. If you've got it, say amen. Amen. All right. Now we got most of the house ready. So, 2 Kings chapter 4, starting in verse 1, it says, "A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets cried out to Elisha, saying, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord. And the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be his slaves.'" Verse 2 says, "So Elisha said to her, 'What shall I do for you? Tell me, what do you have in the house? What do you have in the house?' And she said, 'Your maidservant has nothing in the house but a jar of oil.'" Nothing in the house but a jar of oil. Verse 3 says, "Then he said, 'Go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all of your neighbors. Empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you and your sons, then pour it into all those vessels and set aside the full ones.' So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Now it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, 'Bring me another vessel.' And he said to her, 'There is not another vessel.' So the oil ceased. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons shall live on the rest. This morning, the title of my message is called simply, The Oil. The Oil. In 2 Kings chapter 4, we have a widowed woman. We know a couple of things about this in this text is this woman was a wife of a prophet. Now, this prophet that she was married to is now deceased. So now she is widowed. We know that she has two sons. Something else that we know is she is in a world of hurt. She don't have a lot of money. She don't have a lot of things in her house that she could sell. It sounds like she sold about everything that she could sell to keep her sons out of slavery up until this point. She's held on to the one thing that she thought might could save her life, and guess what? She was right. She held on to the little jar of oil. Now, we don't know how big the jar was. I'm thinking maybe something like this. Maybe that size. That's not very much. I don't know how many ounces that is, but that's not very much. But in that day, olive oil was used to trade with. It was used to barter with. It was used to buy things. You could sell it. You could take it to the market and say, hey, I need a lamb. They'd say, all right, give me 2 ounces of oil. You know, it was used for that type of thing. It was a very respected thing. It represented a lot of things, okay? They could use it for a lot of things. They used it for cooking. They used it for all different sorts of things. They used it to, I'll get to this here in just a minute, but the one thing that's coming to my mind right now is they used it for cooking. They cooked, put it in their meal and their breads and things like that, and they mixed it in and they used it for that. I want to look at what the olive branch, does anybody know where olive oil comes from? I'm sure everybody in this room knows. Where? Olives. Thank you. Olives grow on a tree. It's a huge tree. I didn't know what they grew on until I went over to the motherland of Israel and seen the olive trees, and they are plentiful in certain areas. They're plentiful. Now, not all over the land, but in certain areas they are. And the thing that stuck out to me was when they pluck the olive off of the tree, when they crush it, it looks like blood. Did you know that? It looks like blood. It's a deep, dark, almost black looking. It's dark. Well, when you hit a vein in your body, it's a dark, deep blue tint almost. It's dark. It's very dark blood in your body. Okay? So that's what happens when you crush the olive. It looks like blood. I'll get to that here in just a minute. But the olive branch today, and we look at this and we focus on it, we think of the olive branch or the tree represents peace. It represents triumph, and it represents victory. The oil today in the spiritual and the physical, because we use it physically to anoint people on the head, anoint their hands, we anoint their body, we anoint whatever place of ailment that they may be having, of healing, they're seeking a healing from the Lord. We anoint them because we believe in the power of the Lord that He will heal, not through the oil, but that is symbolic of what we are carrying in us through the power of the Holy Spirit to release into someone the healing that is taking place in their body. The oil represents the anointing. In verse 2, I want to talk about sometimes all you have is more than enough. Sometimes all that you have is more than enough. This oil represented her life savings. This was the last thing. It would be equal to somebody's 401k at this point in today's terms. It would be equal to our 401k, our savings plans that we have for retirement. This was her retirement plan. I can only imagine that her husband being deceased She wouldn't talk about this if she was here today, but he would go around because he was a prophet, and I can see him going around anointing the doorpost, and she's saying, no, don't do that. Don't do that. You don't have to do that. Don't use up my oil. Don't use up our life savings to anoint the doorposts of the house and anoint things in the house and anoint people. Don't use that stuff. I can see that. I can see that now. This represented her life savings. She was hanging on to this. She was clinging to this with everything inside of her. This oil represented her hope. It was the last thing other than her kids that she was clinging to. Her children, her sons, her two sons is all she had left other than the oil, and she was holding on to the oil. Her husband was dead. The creditor was coming to enslave her sons. How many of you in this room can say today with me that you've been in a situation, you've been in a circumstance, you've been in a predicament before that you feel like you don't have what it takes to get out of whatever certain situation that you're in, and somebody is coming to take something of yours to pay your debt? Come on. I've been there, and I didn't know where to turn. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know what in the world I was going to do. But there was something that I was about to lose that was very dear and near to my heart. This woman is in that situation. She's about to lose her son. She's about to lose those children that she birthed, that she went through the labor pains for. She's about to lose those two things. Verse 3, the B part of verse 3 I want to look at. Second thing, do not settle for just enough. Do not settle for just enough. The woman had just enough oil, maybe to pay these creditors off. We don't know that for a fact. We know that the creditors were coming to take her sons. That's all we know. But I want to tell you something today. Do not settle for just enough. Don't settle for just enough Jesus to get you through the day. Don't settle for just enough Jesus to get you through the week. Don't settle for just enough Jesus to get you through 364 more days. I want more of Jesus every single day so that my cup is running over. And when I walk to my job, they can feel a difference in me. They can feel a shift in the atmosphere because of the oil that is overflowing in my life. Do not settle for just enough oil. All the woman had in her possession was one small jar. But when Jesus shows up, when the prophet showed up, when the prophet Elisha showed up to her house, all she had was more than enough. Because when you mix just enough with the word of God, I can tell you one thing. That just enough just doubled. It just tripled. It just met your credit or your debt that you have to pay. Whatever's going on in your life, if you mix it with the word of God, the word will overcome anything. This is tough. I feel like this is... When Jesus shows up in our life, we may sit here and we may say, I don't have anything to offer. I don't have anything to offer that church. I don't have anything to offer my family. I don't have anything to offer my spouse. I don't have anything to offer my children. Listen, people, I'm not talking about a 401k. I'm not talking about a retirement plan. I'm not planning on retiring, okay? I'm planning on meeting Jesus in the cloud of glory when he calls me home in resurrection. That's what I'm calling. That's what I am believing. I'm not worried about a 401k. I'm not worried about a savings plan. I'm not preaching against those things. I understand they're good. I have one, actually. But I'm not preaching against it. I don't want you to get that wrong and get that twisted. But I'm telling you that we've got our thought process. The world today has twisted us and our mind and our way of thinking so much that they have made us think that we can do it all on our own and we don't have to have nobody's help. And when you have to have somebody's help, well, they start looking down their nose at you. I'm here to tell you today, we all need Jesus. Everybody in this room, everybody in the outside these four walls, everybody in this community, everybody in this state, in the tri-state, in the world, cannot do this life without Jesus. You cannot do this life without the Word. You cannot do this life without a prayer life. You cannot do this life without fasting. You cannot do this life You cannot do it without a relationship with the Lord. You cannot, I repeat that, you cannot do this life without a relationship with the Lord. The devil will come at you whether you believe in him, in Jesus or not. The enemy will come at your door whether you believe in Jesus or you do not believe in Jesus. The Bible says that it rains on the just and the unjust. Do not settle for just enough. When Jesus shows up, when the Word shows up, when Elisha shows up, just enough goes out the window. There's no more just scraping by and hoping that what I have will be enough to pay my debts. Jesus paid it all. When His Word comes, it is more than enough to fill that which is empty. Verses 4 through 6, I want to look at this. The oil will flow. This is number 3 if you're numbering these, if you're taking notes. The oil will flow as long as there is a willing vessel. Empty. Empty. I have to question myself. If I'm not empty, am I pouring out? Some of y'all catch that when you get home. I have to question myself, because if I'm not an empty vessel, am I doing what I am called to do by pouring out into others around me in order to become empty so that I can be filled back up? What the woman started with is not what she ended with. The woman started with one small jar of oil. She ended with multiple large vessels that were filled to the brim. They weren't half full. They weren't one quarter full. They weren't three quarters full. They were full to the brim. Now, something strange about that is we talk about overflow. We want to talk about overflow of the Spirit. We want to talk about overflow in that. And I believe that when He gets to pouring Himself out, our bodies are so much that are not enough that we can contain His pouring out. So there is an overflow. But in this text, there's no overflow. There is just enough to fill to the brim. It wasn't empty, because if it had been just a little bit empty, we would consider that full. We consider things that are three quarters full, full. We go ahead and round up. Or at least I do, because I'm not very good with math. If it's three quarters full, it's full. It's good enough. It's full. No. Full to Jesus is not three quarters full. It's not half full. It's not just a little bit of the brim showing. It is to the brim right there. That's full. There's nothing else that can take place in that vessel. Because I'm telling you, if you leave an empty spot in the vessel, something will come along and try to take over the empty space in the vessel. If there's oil to the top, there's nothing else that can be held by the vessel. We have to be willing, church. We have to be willing to open up our hearts and to receive the oil. We have to be willing to open up our hearts and receive the Word in the private time so that we can speak into others when that time comes. She started with one small jar, but the Word of the Lord brought increase to her situation. And as long as there was a vessel not being used for its original intention, the oil flowed to the point of overflow. Can I tell you that an empty vessel is not who you were intended to be? You were not intended to be an empty vessel. You were intended to be full, and full with the power of God, and full with the Holy Ghost, overrunning. You were prepared. You were formed in your mother's womb with that in mind. That was your original intention in this earth, is to be, not just to be an empty vessel, but to be full of the Holy Spirit. That is why you were formed. That is why you were created. As long as there was an empty vessel not being used for its original intent, the oil flowed to the point of overflow. It did not overflow, but it flowed to that point. It flowed to the point of overflow. It did not overflow. But nothing, because nothing was wasted as long as there was another vessel to contain what was being poured out. This is my introduction, by the way. I'm just kidding. I'm teasing. Like Pastor Stewart says, I have 17 closings, I have 17 introductions. I'm just kidding. I want to look at verse 7. This is the last part. We'll look at this and then we'll move on. Verse 7, I want to look at. Then she came and told the man of God and said, go sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons live on the rest. The oil is more than enough. The oil is more than enough. When we are ready to receive the oil, God will not just give us a dab or a small stream. He will pour out His love, His grace, His mercy, His promises, His anointing, His kindness, His faithfulness to us. So much as for us to not be able to contain it, that we have to go gather more empty vessels into the house so that they can receive what the Lord has for them. Our empty vessels could be our friends. It could be our family. It could be our co-workers, our bosses, our children even. Because guess what? They get empty too. They get empty too. But we tend to overlook that, and we're so worried about ourselves, and we're so worried about what's going on in our life. I'm going to tell you something. When this woman was filling these vessels, she was no longer worried about the creditors coming to take her sons. She was just focused on the task at hand, and the word of the Lord was flowing, and the oil was flowing. And as long as the oil is flowing, we're not focused on ourselves. We're not focused on our problems. We're not focused on the things that are trying to come take us captive. We are focused on the flow of oil. We are focused on doing a job for the Lord. That's what we're focused on. We need to gather these vessels so that the overflow will have someone to flow into. There are people that are hurting, dying, and sick, and they're going to hell. They don't know Jesus. That's still preachable, right? Like, if you don't know Jesus, you're going to hell. That last time I looked, that's the only way to heaven. That's the only way to the Father, is through Jesus Christ. He is the door, and He is the only way to the Father, is Jesus. I want to look at Luke chapter 22. A few verses here. Verse 39 through 44. I'm going to read that. Give you just a second to get there. Luke chapter 22, verse 39 through 44. It's on the screens. Verse 39 says, coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done.
Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. A few things I want to look at here. Jesus was being pressed in the garden. The Garden of Gethsemane. Gethsemane actually means the olive press. That's what that word means, olive press. So he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, which is an olive tree grove. There's about six, eight olive trees. They're huge. I mean, I don't know how big around they are. They're massive. Probably three or four people could probably reach around them. They're huge. And they're still there to this day. It's something to see. If you ever get a chance to go to Israel, you need to go. It brings life to the word that you read. But he was in the garden with his disciples, and he was being pressed. He was about to endure the cross, but he was being pressed to the point of agony, to where his sweat was turning to drops of blood. How many of you have prayed that long, prayed that hard? I haven't. I've not prayed to that point. He did this just before he endured the cross to pay for our sins and eternal salvation. The thing that was coming out of him, he was being crushed in the olive grove. He was being crushed in the olive press. And Jesus was being crushed to the point that his blood was running out of him. And that blood is the only thing that will free me and you. His blood is the only thing that paid for our sins in full. We don't owe anything. If we know Jesus and we're washed in the blood of the Lamb, we don't owe anybody anything. You can't buy your way into heaven. You can't barter your way into heaven. You can't go just on good works alone. You can't go just on faith alone. I'm here to tell you and declare to you that today the main olive was pressed in the Garden of Gethsemane to buy you and I out of captivity so we didn't have to live with a yoke of bondage around our neck. That's why he was crushed. That's why he was crushed for you and for me. We crush the olives to get the oil. We crushed them to get the oil. Jesus was crushed so that his blood or his sweat turned to blood. His blood is the only thing that can purchase our salvation. The olive oil was the only thing that could purchase certain things in the widowed woman's day. Just like in 2 Kings chapter 4 with Elisha, the olive oil was the only thing that was going to keep her sons out of captivity. That was the only thing that she was clinging to. I'm telling you, y'all, there's something here, and I'm getting to that point. I am tired of us worrying about what's going on in politics. I'm tired of us worrying about what's going on in the world around us. We're tired of it, but we don't want to do anything about it. We feel like we can't do anything about it, but we don't pray about anything. We don't seek the Lord over anything. We don't read our word anymore. We don't do anything for Jesus anymore. We don't even share the gospel when we go to Walmart. I'm telling you what, he was crushed for our iniquities. He was bruised for our transgressions. And I'm telling you one thing, and I'm telling you one thing this morning. He loves you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. If you feel like sharing the gospel with somebody in the Walmart line, I say do it, because the blood was shed for them too. And the oil that you feel is running into that person. The oil is anointing. I'm telling you, I want more of the oil. I can't preach without the oil. Pastor Stewart can't preach without the oil. You can't live without the oil. You can't proclaim to be a Christian without the oil. I'm telling you, something's breaking in this house. Something's breaking in this room. I don't mean to scream. I don't mean to yell. But I'm telling you, this is passionate on the inside of me. I'm tired of sitting on the sidelines and letting them say Christians don't have a say anymore. We can't even tell the difference between a man and a woman when we're asked. We can't define man. We can't define woman. Let me help you. Man is born a man. He's born with that genitalia. A woman is born with theirs. I'm telling you right now, it was established in Genesis, and it will be forevermore. I do not care what the enemy says. I don't care what agenda they have. The oil is starting to flow again because there's empty vessels in the house. I told you it's hard. The introduction is hard. We don't want to hear none of the backstory of anything. Whew. Olive oil was used to cook with. It was used to anoint. They would even mix spices and fragrances with it to anoint the dead bodies. Come on. The woman from Bethany, the prostitute from Bethany, broke a jar, an alabaster jar of oil and fragrances and perfume over her Savior's head or over his feet. And she began to get on her hands and knees and she began to wash his feet with her hair. I'm telling somebody, if you would take a low spot, if you would take a servant spot and you would say, I'm an empty vessel, fill me up, Jesus. If you would take that low spot instead of wanting to be promoted to the top at the very first, I'm telling you, Jesus will take you places where you never thought that you would go. I'm living proof. I don't have the right degree. I don't have the right credentials. I don't have the right last name. I don't have any of that. But I got contacted while I was at the beach the other day about a job that is unfathomable to me. I can't even imagine why I'm getting contacted. I'm not here to bring light on me. I'm just telling you, without the oil, without the oil, there cannot be promotion. Without the oil, there is no anointing. Without the oil, people stay in captivity without the oil. Something I got out of this Luke chapter 22 verses of scripture is when you feel your greatest crushing, you're about to experience your greatest breakthrough. Oh my God. When you feel your greatest crushing, I'm telling you right now, somebody's getting freed in this house right now. When you feel your greatest crushing and you're being crushed and pressed on every single side, I'm here to tell you that the enemy is not going to take you out. You are about to experience the greatest breakthrough in your life. Though the floodwaters rage, I will not be drowned. Though I walk through the fire, the hair on my head will not be singed. Come on, somebody. If there's a day ever more that we're walking through fire, every single day our foot hits the floor, it is today. We need the oil. We need the oil. He was being pressed for our transgressions. He was being bruised for our iniquities. Come on, somebody. Just because you're getting crushed a little bit don't mean the enemy's got you. Just because you're being crushed a little bit don't mean the enemy's going to take you out. Just because you're being crushed, you know what that tells me? That the anointing is about to start flowing even greater than it's ever flowed before. Whew. Thank you, Lord. Olive oil was used for restoring old wineskins. I don't know why I'm talking about wineskins, but the Lord laid this on my heart, and I'm going to talk about it. There's some people in this room right now and probably listening online that feel used up. They feel useless. They feel dried up. They feel like if they can't contain the anointed. They can't contain what God has in store for them. I'm here to tell you that there's a flow of fresh oil that is coming from the throne room of heaven. And if you get up under that fresh oil, He will restore you back to what you were, even better. You will be able to contain what He has in store for you. I'm telling you, let's go into this a little bit. Wineskins were made out of animal skins, usually goat or sheep. They were usually goat or sheepskin. They used this to transport the wine. They used this to transport the wine. The Bible says that new wine cannot be placed into old wineskins. That the reason is when they would pour the wine out and the wineskin would become empty and used up and it didn't have a use anymore, it was empty, it would dry out and it would become brittle and it would become hard. And then when you put new wine in the old wineskin was not able to contain the new wine. So it would burst. And all the new wine would be wasted onto the ground. I'm going somewhere. Sorry, I'm old school, and I'm old school. I'm 35, and I'm writing on pen and paper. I don't have an iPad. I don't even own an iPad. I have a computer, but that's too bulky up here. I'm sorry for flipping pages. They became hard, they became brittle, they became... New wine was poured into these old wineskins. They would burst if they were old, if they were not pliable to... Because that wine would swell and it would swell and it was going through a fermenting process. Pour out and it would spill all the wine. I'm going to tell you something. And you probably already know this, but I'm going to tell it anyway. It's probably been preached 10 ways to Sunday. But I feel like this is what the word of the Lord has in store for us today. The only way to restore an old wineskin was to soak it in oil. I'm going to say it one more time. The only way to restore an old wineskin was to soak it in the oil. Not only that, they would massage it into the skin and they would begin to stretch it and they would begin to form it to what it was. I feel like God is stretching some folks in here today. I feel like God is stretching some folks at Fairview. You're doing some things. You're talking to people that you never thought you would talk to. You're sharing the gospel around people that you said, I never would in the million years would have done this 5 or 6 or 8 or 10 or 15 years ago. But God is beginning to put new oil in your life and He's beginning to stretch you and He's beginning to massage you and He's beginning to get that oil down into the deepest fibers of who you are so that you're not dried up anymore. You're not brittle anymore because He's getting ready to pour out new wine of the Holy Spirit in your life and you are going to do great and mighty things for the Lord. This process would restore the material back to its original intention, allowing it to be used over and over and over. The Bible says, Jesus even tells His disciples that you can't take new cloth and put on an old wineskin, then pour new wine into it. You can't just patch it up. Come on. You can't just patch it up. You can't just put a Band-Aid on it. You can't just halfway do something. You gotta labor for a moment. You gotta labor for a moment. We all look at the end result of something and we get it in our sights and we say, man, if I was only there. But we forget the 10 years that it takes us to get to that point. Everybody wants to talk about the start and the finish. The middle of the race, nobody looks at. I know Chad's here this morning. I'm going to use you for a second. Nobody thinks about the training and the hours and the sweat and the tears that you put in and the bruises and the cuts and the things you get in training to get ready for a fight. Am I right? Nobody looks at that part. Nobody looks at that part. They just look at Conor McGregor on UFC and think, man, that guy's worth billions of dollars. I would, you know, I'm in church. I would tell you why he's worth that. It ain't because of fighting. But I know why. It ain't because of fighting. I'm not taking anything away from him. He puts in the work. You see these athletes? You see these people? They put in the work. What's wrong with us, church? We want our great reward in heaven, but we don't put in the work. We want our great reward. We want that paycheck at the end of 2 weeks, but we don't want to do nothing for it. Our world, our country is in a world of hurt right now because a lot of people don't want to work. Jesus worked, and he was the Son of Almighty God, and he still worked. He was the fleshly son of a carpenter. If it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Work never hurt nobody. It never killed nobody last time I checked. But I'm telling you in the spiritual, we need to start putting some work in. We need to start putting some hours in. We will make time for TV. We'll make time for Facebook. We'll make time for Instagram and Twitter or whatever's out there right now. Snapchat, I think. I don't even know. That's bad, ain't it? I'm the youth pastor. And we'll make time for all of that stuff. But for Jesus, we want to turn our nose up and say, you know what? I prayed for 5 seconds today. I read my verse of the day on the Bible app. I'm telling you, it's more than a verse of the day. It is a hand-holding, neck-hugging relationship every single day of the week. Come on, I know this is hard. Nobody wants to hear this part. That was your intention. That was your original intent, was to walk hand in hand with him in the cool of the garden. Go back to Genesis chapter 1 and 2 if you want to know your original intention. It takes work. It's labor. You're going to face stuff. You're going to face devils you never thought you would face. You're going to have people talk about you. You're going to have people backbite you. You're going to have people try to cut your head off right in the front of a crowd. But I'm telling you what, if you know who Jesus is, he is our rock. He is our foundation. He is our strong tower. He is the one who I run to in my biggest time of need. He is the only one. We are the wineskins, people. We're the wineskins. Last time I read my Bible, we are the vessels that contain the same Holy Spirit. Get this, that raised Christ Jesus from the dead. Woo! I think it's in John chapter 14. Jesus is talking to his disciples. He says, the things that I have done, that you've seen me do, these things and greater things will you do. Not because of who you are. Not because of your last name. Not because of your credentials or your title. But because of who he is, he is pouring out his spirit. We have to be a willing vessel. We have to be a vessel ready to receive. We have to be a vessel that's been stretched and been massaged and sometimes even been crushed to be able to receive what God has for us. We are the wineskins. The Holy Spirit is the new wine. And the anointing, the restoring agent, is Jesus. It's Jesus. The restoring agent in your life is Jesus Christ. It's nothing else. It's not a 12-step program. It's Jesus Christ crucified, died, buried in a borrowed tomb, risen, and now sits at the right hand of the Father. That is our restore. He is our restoring agent. What time is it? 11:17. I'm not preaching as long as I thought I was. I don't know, probably. I'll be quiet. Jesus is the restoring agent in an encounter with his blood that he spilled for us on Calvary, that came out of that container on the cross. And when he was pierced, and the Bible says blood and water flowed from him and ran down Calvary. For you and for me, we've got to get back to the cross, people. We've got to get back to the cross. We've got to get back to the cross. Not because that's where Jesus is hanging still, because he sits at the right hand of the Father. We've got to get to the altar. We've got to get to the cross. We've got to get to the place where restoration happens, where massaging happens, where stretching happens right there, because he was stretched far and wide and lifted up, and his hands were pierced and his feet were pierced, and they pushed a crown of thorns down on his head and they pierced him in the side, and they said when they punctured his heart, blood and water flowed from him. I'm telling you right now, we have to get to that place to have restoration in our life. We have to get to that place to have healing in our life. We have to get to that place for more kindness and more gentleness and more love in our life. Come on, somebody. That's where the fruit comes from. When the oil flows, there is always resurrection to follow. I'm going to look at three things and then I'm going to keep going. You thought I was going to say I was done, didn't you? I'm going to keep going. When the oil flows, there's always resurrection to follow. 1 Kings, I'm going to prove it to you. 1 Kings 17, 16 through 23. I'm not going to read it. This is the Jaron paraphrase. In 1 Kings, the Bible talks about Elijah, the prophet, going to a widowed woman's home. It took me a minute. I was like, I'm missing something here. I thought this was the same story. Mm-mm. Elijah in 1 Kings. Elijah goes to the widow woman's home, and he says, make me a meal, make me a cake for you, me, you, and your sons. She said, all I have is a little bit of meal to make the bread, make the cake, and a small jar of oil. Before this, he tells the same woman that she's going to have a child later the next year. So he comes and he tells her something crazy like that, because she's on up in age. Then he tells her to make a cake for the house. Nothing ran dry. The oil did not run out. She had enough to make the cake, feed him, her sons, and the entire house, the Bible says. Well, has a child. He comes back. Child gets sick, dies. She said, the child you promised me, you told me that the Lord had promised me, has died. He says, where's the boy? She said, he's in the upper room. He said, let me to him. He goes in the room, he opens the door, he shuts it behind him. It's him and the boy, the dead man, dead young man on the bed. He does something crazy. He lays this boy stretched out across the bed. He lays on top of him. The boy resurrects. He's alive. He gets him up, takes him to his mama. Now in 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. Elisha is in this woman's home talking about the oil. He goes to a Shunammite woman, and she has a son who is sick. He says, where's the boy? This is Elisha now, not Elijah. We can only do what we see our... You're going to catch this in a minute. We can only do what we see our fathers do. His spiritual father, Elijah, had raised a boy in 1 Kings. I'm sure he told Elisha about this story every single day. Elisha encounters the same problem. He encounters a widowed woman who has nothing but a jar of oil to pay the creditors off, to come in that are coming to take his sons. And he says, give me the vessels. Give me the empty vessels. Give me the empty vessels. The oil begins to run. The oil begins to run. It flows, flowing, flowing, flowing. Goes to a Shunammite woman in the same town. Her son is sick to the point of death. Dies. He says, where's the boy? In his room. He does the same exact thing that Elijah done in 1 Kings. Guess what? The boy resurrected. Luke 22, the oil was flowing in the Garden of Gethsemane. The oil began to flow. And when they pierced his side on the cross, the rest of that oil was spilled out on the ground. And I'm telling you right now, when they buried him in the borrowed tomb, they thought he was there for sure. I'm telling you one thing right now, and one thing only, that Jesus Christ did not stay in that tomb. That stone was rolled away. The guard was asleep. The angel of the Lord appeared, and he resurrected out of that tomb, and he lives today to sit at the right hand of the Father. The only way resurrection will come is if the oil flows first. We have to be crushed. We have to be crushed. We have to be squeezed. We think that's the end of everything. We think it's the end. I'm almost done. Kason, if you would, come gather the troops and we'll get ready to land this plane. It's a big plane. I'm just kidding. I need to tell somebody that the oil will free that which they are coming to take captive or is already enslaved. That is the only thing that will free you. That's the only thing that will free you. Jesus and His blood sets us free from the power of sin and darkness, frees the captive from bondage to sin. He came so that He could set the captive free. Just like in the widow's story of the widow woman, the oil will secure our days. You may be not sure of where you're going, but I'm telling you, the oil will secure your days. The oil of Jesus, the flow of the anointing will secure your days. The woman had enough not only to keep her sons out of bondage, but to live on the rest for the rest of her days. John 3:15, 16, and 17 says that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. He died for you. He died for you. in this place today. He was crushed for you. I was talking to Kyler Wednesday night, and he was telling me that he had some kind of issue with water or something, and he had a water pump. It was his Papaw Tony's. Older pump. Hadn't been used much, but it was old. And he said, I went and I put gas in it and I cranked it up and started transferring the water. He said it ran for a little bit. And all of a sudden it locked up. Burnt the motor up. He said, I looked, it didn't have no oil in it. I wonder today how many are sitting in this room and in this community that have no oil. You've been running on empty for a long time. You're to the point of burnout. You're to the point of locking up. You're to the point of throwing in the towel and quitting. Because you don't know what to do. I'm telling you, today is the day that you get filled with the oil. I want more of the oil. You may have come in this place, you may be completely empty. You may be to the point of burnout, you may be to the point of locking up. You may be to the point of quitting and throwing in the towel and saying, I'm done with it, I'm done with that. I'm done with trying to follow Jesus, I'm done. I'm done with people. I'm gonna tell you something, people gonna hurt you. People will talk about you, people will hurt you. But I'm gonna tell you this, if people ain't talking about you, if people ain't trying to come at you and hurt you and take what you've got, if they ain't trying to do that to you, you ain't in the right place. You're already out of oil because they want the oil. They want to come for the oil. They're trying to lock you up. They're trying to burn you out. They're trying to run you dry so that you quit and you say, I'm done. That's what the enemy wants from you today. He wants you to say, I'm finished. I'm done. I don't want any more of that church. I don't want any more of that place. I don't want any more of that religion. I don't want any more of that. But I'm telling you that today you can be filled afresh. You can be filled anew. You can be filled to the point of overflowing, and you will not ever run dry, because I'm telling you, Jesus Christ is the only one who will fill you to that point. I want to be soaked in the oil of Jesus Christ and His anointing. If I had time, I'd go into how they use the oil to anoint prophets. They use the oil to anoint priests. And they use the oil to anoint kings. Well, what is Jesus? Jesus is a prophet. He is the ultimate prophet. He is the high priest. He is the King of Kings. And He is the Lord of Lords. So we don't need to anoint Him. He is the one who anoints us. Everyone would, if you stand. I want to look at us as a whole right now. 2 Kings chapter 4, the woman represented the church. Anytime you see a woman spoken about in Scripture, you can relate her to the church, because we are the bride of Christ. 2 Kings chapter 4, this widowed woman, she is representative of the church. Her two sons were about to be given up to the creditors and put into slavery, into bondage. But thank you, Jesus, that the word of the Lord came by. How many of you are thankful for the word this morning? How many of you are thankful that the word just passed by you today? And Elisha is the word. He is symbolic of Christ in this scripture. He is the word of God. He was the mouthpiece for the Lord. That's what the prophet was in those days. He was the mouthpiece of the Lord. In order for us as the church to operate in our original intention, we've got to be a house full of oil. Number one. Number two, the word of God must be preached in here, and not just in here, but outside these four walls. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads, close your eyes in reverence to the Lord this morning. I hope and pray that the Lord drops something into your spirit this morning through this word. But just because Pastor Stewart's not here don't mean that we can't have altar call, and don't mean that we can't pray through, and don't mean that we can't pray healing over somebody. We will anoint the sick and pray the prayer of faith that they may be healed. Now that sickness may not be a physicality. It may be an emotional sickness. It may be a financial sickness. It may be something going on with your emotions and your mind. It may be something going on, a war in your spirit and your flesh. It may be something like that. I'm telling you right now that the oil is here. And it's not just this oil in this bottle. It is Jesus Christ and Christ alone. He is the oil. So if you're here in this place and you're empty, you're run dry, you're to the point of burnout, locking up, quitting, giving in, throwing in the towel, slip your hand up right now. Just in the privacy of this, we're not going to try to make anybody embarrassed. If you're in this place and you feel like you're only half full, like you there's more for you. You want more, slip your hand up. If you want more, come on. If you want more, slip your hand up. Slip it up, slip it right back down. If you're in this place and you feel like you're used up, you're no good, good for nothing, because you've heard that more than one time, I'm here to tell you that your Heavenly Father is speaking to your heart right now and saying, I love you, I created you, I formed you, I anointed you, and I have kept you to this point. If that's you in this room, slip your hand up, slip it right back down in this room right now. Come on, I'm going to do it like I do it on Wednesday nights. We give altar calls out there at the youth. Y'all may believe that or not. We do it. We break out the oil. We anoint folks. We pray for people. I know that there's some people in here that want more. You want more. Come on, I'm going to count to three. Just start singing and playing something. I'm going to count to three. I'm going to give it. I'm going to do it like they do it on TV. Okay? I'm going to count to three, and then we're going to fill these altars up. And we're going to start praying one for another. Come on. One, two, three. Come on, get down here. Come on. If you want more of the oil, Come on. If you want more, Jesus is here. He's meeting you right here. He's meeting you right here. If you want more, come on, you don't have to have me to lay hands on you. Just come get in the flow of oil. Just get in the flow of oil. Come on, can I get some prayer warriors to gather around these right here that are up front and begin to pray? Just begin to pray. Lay your hands on them, begin to pray.
I give you my worship, and you still deserve it. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy of my song. I pour out your praises in blessing and breaking. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy of my song. To my soul that you've already won. And even though I can't see it, I'm gonna keep believing that every promise you've made is as good as done. I give you my worship, 'cause you still deserve it. Pour out your praises in blessing and breaking. You're worthy, you're worthy, Jesus, you're worthy of my soul. You're worthy, you're worthy, Jesus, you're worthy of my soul. You're worthy, you're worthy. Stop singing your praise. I'll never stop singing your praise.
And in the blessing and the pain, you are worthy. Whether you say yes or no or wait, you are worthy. And through it all I choose to say, you are worthy. I'll never stop singing your praise. I'll never stop singing your praise.
Anointing will rescue, it will restore, and it will keep you. The anointing will rescue, it will restore, and it will keep you. Before I dismiss in prayer, if you're a new guest with us today, please see Miss Sandy Holman and the First Impressions team out at the front front there, and they've got a gift for you. They got a gift bag for you. Oh yeah, there she goes. That's your cue, Sandy. Oh me, we love you. We love you on behalf of Pastor Stewart, Fairview Church. We love you. Yes, 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 yes. Come on, let's gather around Kyler. Everybody that is able and that can, let's gather around him. I believe he's having surgery tomorrow. Is that right? Tomorrow in the morning. Where's it? Okay. Going to be at Erlanger. T.C. Thompson's at Erlanger. The Lord has his hand on Kyler. I believe that. I know that. Without a shadow of a doubt, I know that God has his hand on Kyler. He has his hands on the doctors, the nurses, the anesthesiologists, whoever's involved in his case. I know that right now God is appointing those people to be in his path. I know that. I know that. So if you would, let's just gather in prayer. We're going to anoint Kyler and we're going to pray for him, pray over him. Thank you. love you. We're praying for you. Father, we thank you for your love and your mercy that we felt in this room today, for your grace that we felt in this room. God, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that not only just meets us in these four walls, but goes with us wherever we go. That same Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead now lives on the inside of us. God, we're speaking over people today. We're speaking that the anointing would begin to flow over their lives, God. Let it flow again, God. Those empty vessels, God, you begin to fill them right now in the name of Jesus. Those old, brittle, dried up wineskins, God, you soak them in the oil of your presence and you begin to massage them and begin to stretch them right now in the name of Jesus so that we can contain more of you, Holy Spirit. We thank you for everything that you've done in this place today and everything that you're going to do. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
I wasn't in here, so I didn't know.
Oh, good.